seconds and counting. Good evening, welcome to the November 19th, 1996, Town of Cape Elizabeth Planning Board meeting. First item on the agenda is minutes of the previous meeting. And does anyone have any comments or corrections regarding those minutes? Mr. Emery?
Mr. Chairman, page four, the next to the last paragraph, last sentence, reference to Mr. Emery will stay with condition one of his motion. I believe in reference to the two conditions that the both one and two should have been stated as items that I would have stayed with. The discussion, as I recall, was around the issue of the 14-foot wide driveway with 2-foot wide shoulders.
Thank you. Any other questions or corrections or have you? Seeing none, do I have a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move that the minutes be accepted as amended.
Second.
All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Okay, correspondence. Let's see, on the podium tonight, there is a letter from Town Manager Michael McGovern regarding the status of the Highlands of Broad Cove, which will be addressed after we finish the correspondence. A letter from a town attorney regarding the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, Hobstone, the conservation easement, I believe, without reading the letter. A letter from the Conservation Commission regarding Mullins Wetlands alteration permit. And a letter to Maureen O'Meara, town planner, from Vaughn Dyer regarding site distance for 250 Ocean House Road. And a letter to Rick Light, land use consultants, regarding the Monk's utility extension. Also, a letter from the town manager regarding Dominicus Crossing, Planning Commissioner's Journal, Fall 1996 issue, Zoning News, October 1996. Letter from R. McGinley regarding Connor Lane, Cape Courier article regarding Dominicus Crossing, and Shoreland Zoning News, Fall 1996. Mr. McGovern is asked to speak to the Planning Board regarding the Highlands, and as in the past, I will step down for this particular item, and Ms. McKay will take the chair.
Mr. Chairman, I also have to recuse myself from any discussions.
Mr. McGovern, why don't we give the members of the Planning Board a chance to read your letter, because I think it was just placed before their noses a moment ago. This is the letter from Michael McGovern, dated November the 18th, status of Highlands at Broad Cove.
Mr.
Hey, Mr. McGovern, just, I guess I thought perhaps it would be a good idea just to get Mr. Cotter on board with this, since he was absent at the August the 20th meeting, to simply read part of the minutes of that meeting to set the stage. If you'll bear with me, I'll do this as quickly as I can. Mr. McGovern explained that the usual legal firm, this is with respect to the Highlands, Peter, that the usual legal firm representing the town has sometimes represented the bank that holds the letter of credit, so for this action, they have attorneys who would not have a conflict of interest, and with him is James Katsiafakis of the Jensen Baird Law Firm. Mr. McGovern said that letters of credit are in place to ensure that a project is done and that it is done on time. The ordinance does allow some flexibility, recognizing that other factors may cause a project to have some problems. That has been the case for nearly every project the town has dealt with in recent years. He said the town is not hesitant to call a letter of credit when it appears that it is in the best interests of the town to do so. This particular project has been extremely difficult. Very strong consideration has been given along the way to call the letter of credit. He has to consider what are the likely actions to occur if they call the letter of credit versus what it is like to, what is likely to occur if they do not do it. In each instance, he has concluded it is in the best interest of the town to not call the letter of credit. He said he has had numerous discussions with Mr. Kennedy where it was alleged there was poor treatment by the town. There was a question of how it might be carried forward if it went to court. Mr. Kennedy made a strong case that the project was not at a point where enough had gone forward, that if it went to court, he would file suit against us to tie up the funds so that the town could not then go forward and do the work. Mr. McGovern felt that it was in the best interests of the town and everyone concerned to try to do something to move the project forward instead of keeping it in limbo. He also said that if they had not extended the letter of credit, they would have been in the situation of the project being dead with Mr. Kennedy still owning the land. He was being cautious of the town not getting into the situation of takings, et cetera. He stated that the letter of credit would not be extended in November. Ms. McKay asked what the legal issue would have been if a decision had been made to call the letter of credit and the project was 40% lacking. Mr. McGovern said the project was closer to 10% being completed and was at a point where Mr. Kennedy was at a state where he wanted to abandon it. Mr. McGovern said one of the issues is this town's desire to have an emergency access road for Broad Cove and a looped water line. These two major improvements would be in the best interest of the town. Attorney Katsiafakis said control over how the project is carried out is in the letter of credit. He said a schedule is provided, initially a period of from 1 to 3 years with extensions for good cause shown. He said the protections he is now asking are a correction of the dates to indicate the sequence, that there be a 30-day opportunity to inspect the public improvements, to allow inspection by the town engineer to make sure they are satisfactory before a decision is made to pull the letter of credit. An exception is to be made to allow the final coat of paving to be placed next spring. If everything but that is done before November the 21st, the letter of credit will not be pulled. An escrow would be established for the paving to be completed by June the 1st of '97. Mr. Katsiafakis feels that it is in the best to allow this work to go forward, but with the understanding that this would be the last extension of the letter of credit. And then he suggested certain amendments to the letter of credit. The board passed the amendments to the subdivision with seven different conditions, including the attorney's recommendations, and also including a standard clause that the drafts be allowed to complete improvements or to restore the subdivision parcel. So, Mr. McGovern would now like to catch us up to date.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman, for first of all allowing me to speak during correspondence. A little bit unusual, I know, and not customary to what the planning board does. I think your reading of those minutes indicates the reason that I'm here this evening. is the fact that, you know, this is an issue that has been of quite a bit of concern to the planning board and to the community, and some of what was said back at that previous meeting isn't necessarily what's being proposed at this point in time, so I wanted to clarify whether there are some variances and the reasons for them. There's nothing I'd like to be able to say more this evening than the project is done. Isn't this terrific? Unfortunately, because of a variety of circumstances, it isn't quite done, but overall, the news is very, very positive and very good. Shortly after the planning board approval, several months ago, the water line was in fact installed using the crews of the Portland Water District. It was a difficult process and was difficult to get the district here at the time, but through their cooperation and with the work of the contractor working for Mr. Kennedy, that was able to become to be accomplished. The water line on Channel View Road is also substantially in. There's a small piece. Unfortunately, because of the October floods, the water district has not been as responsive as we'd like them to be, and I don't mean that as a criticism of the water district. It's just a fact that because of the unexpected rains in mid-October that they haven't been back to do some of the inspections and the other work that that they were ultimately going to do. It had been my intent, and overall, as this memo shows, you know, the project is very much nearing completion. My intent was to assess the project at this point in time and to set up an escrow account for completing the work that was to be done instead of extending the letter of credit. What I ended up finding out, unfortunately, was the fact that we were planning to use the money that was in the escrow account for the water line, which is in addition to the letter of credit, to provide the funds for the new escrow to complete the paving and the other work that needed to be done in lieu of the letter of credit. What I've discovered is the water district has not yet even billed Mr. Kennedy for any of the water line work. Therefore, we do need to keep that money, continue to keep it in the escrow account until the water district completes figuring out its charges and gives Mr. Kennedy the bill. There's every indication, I've spoken as late as today with the engineer who is inspecting the project for Mr. Kennedy. I spoke with our engineer earlier this week, as well as met with Mr. Kennedy on the site yesterday. Every indication is the project will move forward very positively. At least one lot has closed. I keep getting phone calls continuously with very, very active interest in the lots. Mr. Kennedy's banker, in fact, is so pleased with the progress and the interest that he is about to, indicated on the phone when I spoke to him yesterday, offer the financing and the letter of credit for the next and final phase of the project. So all in all, it is in good shape. I do believe, as the preamble to all of that discussion indicated, that, you know, now that we do have a developer who is working very positively, getting things done, that it is wise to work with him to see the project through, to continue with the next phase, since the bank is now ready to loan the funds, and particularly to do this in an economic climate that looks good for the project. So I'd be happy to answer any questions that you may have on any aspect of the project.
Any questions? Mr. Carlson?
I have one question about that huge ditch or at the end of the road there. I haven't been down there. Has that all been taken care of? We had some people in the audience way back kind of complain about that. Has that all been kind of straightened out to the satisfaction of those neighbors?
Yeah, there's several different ditches. There's a major ditch all along Jordan Farm Pond Road, whatever it's called, that is being kept open, waiting to put the electric line in, and CMP is supposed to be there on Thursday.
Well, this was a drainage. This
is the one next to the Boxer's home?
Yes.
Yeah, most of that work has been done, but that is the real point of contention the last day or two, is the fact that we want Boxer's driveway, or that section of it that is on the road, repaved so that they will continue to have a full paved driveway out to Winding Way for the winter.
Thank you.
Any other comments from board members? No? Well, Mr. Wilburn, I'm disturbed about the fact of your being here again, which obviously doesn't surprise you from my comments the last time. Did you consider pulling the letter of credit and getting the rest of the work done?
I did consider that, and I considered it in terms of also, as I mentioned, combining it with the water amount, but, you know, I just can't see calling a letter of credit when the contractor is out there every single day making positive progress, and that's what's going on at this point. When we call the letter of credit, we take over management of the project, and I don't, you know, when a project is currently being well managed in the field, I don't see an imperative for the town government to take it over.
Well, I guess what disturbs me is the repeated disruption of the citizenry in Broad Cove, but I have been on record on that before. The other thing that disturbs me about this particular letter of credit is that one of the specific requirements, conditions of approval by the planning board was that the letter of credit incorporate what I consider to be quite standard language, which is you may use any draft to complete the improvements or to restore the subdivision parcel. And on the bank president's suggestion, which is a little suspect to start with, his idea was we weren't going to do anything but business as usual, and the town's interim attorney agreed to that, and apparently you had no objection. I don't understand the reason for agreeing to delete that particular provision specifically, particularly because it was specifically designated as a condition of approval.
I can't really speak to that. The town's attorney on this particular instance took that action when I was out of the country, didn't check with me. He didn't feel that it was that significant. I really can't respond to that.
Well, I would hope that for any letter of credit on any future phase that be just incorporated, because it's actually a distinct benefit to the town to be able to use the monies for that purpose as well.
I do think it was very positive that we had the letter of credit reviewed by an attorney, not from a customary firm, because he did make several recommendations in the letter of credit, which will strengthen all of our letters of credit in the future by having had more than one firm. Now, having reviewed our letters of credit, we're tightening them up all the time.
But I hope he didn't give away anything valuable on this one.
I don't believe so.
Well, if there are no further comments from the board, thank you for your report.
Good.
And I guess this is an ongoing saga.
I think it's an ongoing positive story for the town that we've worked with a developer to achieve some very positive public aims, particularly the completion of a looped water line, as well as an emergency access out of Broad Cove. When I look at the correspondence in the town since the 1970s on this issue, I think the town has showed, you know, very good forbearance in working to make sure that this project does get done. And I do regret the negative impacts it has had on some of the residents of Broad Cove, but I think their long-term interests have definitely been served. So thank you.
Thank you for your report.
Thank you, Ms. McKay. First item under new business is Hobstone Subdivision Amendment, request by the Hobstone Owners Association, the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, for an amendment to the Hobstone Subdivision located off Mitchell Road to separate Phase 3 as a lot and conserve it as open space, Section 16-2-5, amendment to a previously approved subdivision. The applicant wish to address us.
My name is John Mitchell, and I'm a member of the Board of Directors of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. The Land Trust has entered into a contract with the Gorham Savings Bank to acquire the property of what is known as Phase 3 of Hobstone Condominium Project. And we've worked very closely with the Homeowners Association, and in doing so, we have come up with three easements which will be incorporated into the acquisition of this property, which are outlined in your, on the first page of your cover letter. The first easement is an access easement across and over Hobstone Drive, which will allow both pedestrians and motor vehicles. It extends from Mitchell Road to the terminus of Hobstone Drive. The second easement is to allow us to build two parking spaces at the end of Hobstone Drive. And the third easement is to allow us to have pedestrian access from across a small portion of what is Phase 1 to get to Phase 3, together with allowing us to construct a footpath and signage. It is our intention to convey or to offer the town, once this acquisition is complete, to offer the town a conservation easement on Phase 3. It really is a magnificent piece of property. It will offer passive recreational opportunities and activities such as cross-country skiing, hiking, and picnicking. And lastly, it will connect some existing easements and open spaces that the, either the town or the land trust have now in connecting or linking the Greenbelt plan. So we are here to get approval for a previously approved subdivision to subdivide or divide Phase 3 out as a separate lot. And I'll be glad to answer any questions, and Nat Clifford is here to help me with the answers.
Any questions or of the applicant? Mr. Emery?
I just think for the public record it might be good, John. I know there were questions during the workshop with respect to the density calculations for the existing development, and if there's anything that's happened with the subdivision conditions of approval or regulations that are affected by the carving off of this third parcel.
In terms of the Phase 1 and Phase 2, there are, I believe, 66 units that have been constructed. Phase 3 would have permitted 33 additional units. Is that...
Yeah, I not to put words in your mouth, but what I think is important for the public record or for anyone watching television, and there's nothing about the subdivision of this parcel and the granting of this conservation easement apart from the condominium association that makes any of the existing development non-conforming with respect to open space.
Yeah, I honestly have not checked into whether this causes any implications to the existing condominium project in terms of the open space.
I think this is a wonderful thing you're doing. I'm not trying to raise a red flag here. I just wanted it for the record, Maureen.
And I know we talked about this before, but the way you may want to look at it is if this was being proposed as a condominium project right now without any condominium units on it, and you were to have proposed before you one large parcel, and the way they were going to meet their open space requirement is they were going to carve off one piece and give it to the town or the land trust with a conservation easement, that would be a technique that a developer could use to meet the open space requirement.
Okay. Thank you. Second question, I have two other questions. One, there's a note about the existing 25-foot wide pedestrian easement. I assume that was part of a previously approved subdivision that shows up on what will become the recording plat. Will that continue to be granted to the citizens of Cape Elizabeth for rights of access?
Yes. That one, this is a 25-foot easement that was granted to the town of Cape Elizabeth back when the original subdivision was prepared. and that will remain.
Great.
As part of the plan.
And lastly, I apologize for bringing this up at this late date. I forgot to call the town planner. Are there any DEP applications or anything that needs, and again, this is just so everything's clean and tidy, anything with respect to any DEP site location approvals that would be affected by this?
We have submitted this amended subdivision plan to DEP, and we have received their approval.
You have received their approval?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions?
Ms. McKay?
I have a motion to propose.
Any other questions or comments before? Please do.
Motion for the board to consider findings of fact. Number one, the Hobstone Owners Association and the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust are proposing to divide Phase 3 of the Hobstone subdivision into a separate lot and to conserve it as open space, which requires approval under Section 16-2-5, amendment to a previously approved subdivision. Number two, a conservation easement to be dedicated to the town has been proposed by the applicant. Number three, the application substantially complies with the requirements of Section 16-2-5, amendment to a previously approved subdivision. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Hobstone Owners Association and the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust to divide Phase 3 of the Hobstone subdivision into a separate lot and conserve it as open space be approved, subject to the following condition. One, that the proposed conservation easement be reviewed and approved by the town attorney.
Thank you.
I forgot to mention, I'm sorry. My understanding is that the Owners Association, the Board of Directors of the Hobstone Owners Association, have voted in favor of this acquisition. However, the members have not, and they're right now in the process of submitting their proxies. We would request that submission of the evidence of the approval of the membership of the Hobstone Owners Association be submitted and make that a condition of this approval.
Thank you. You want to add a number two, or do you want to just go with this?
Subject to the following conditions, the one I've already stated, and number two, that the membership of the Hobstone Owners Association affirmatively vote to divide Phase 3 of the Hobstone subdivision into a separate lot.
Thank you. Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor, please raise your right hand.
Mr. Chairman, discussion?
I'm sorry. We were just moving along so quickly, I thought we'd just keep going.
As one planning board member, I would really like to congratulate the Land Trust and the Hobstone Homeowners Association. This is a most remarkable and unusual situation, given the value of not only land, but particularly previously approved developments, and particularly in the town of Cape Elizabeth. This is, I think, quite a unique situation, at least for the 6 years that I've been sitting on this planning board, and I congratulate everyone involved.
Yes, I really would like to second that. It obviously took work by everybody, including the bank, to be willing to allow this to happen.
Any other comments or discussion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Okay, the next item on the agenda is the Mullen Daycare Site Plan Wetland Alteration Permit. Request by Pamela and Peter Mullen for a site plan review of a daycare home and a wetland alteration permit for an addition to their home located at 44 Two Lights Road, Section 19-2-10, site plan completeness and public hearing and sections 19-3-9, wetland alteration permit completeness and public hearing. Good evening.
Good evening.
Would you introduce yourselves, please, and please begin when you're ready.
Pamela Mullen, 44 Two Lights Road.
And Peter Mullen, 44 Two Lights Road.
Would you like to make a brief presentation?
Sure.
Okay.
The purpose of this project is to put an addition onto our existing home, which will include a new space for my school, which I've operated in our home 4 years here in Cape Elizabeth and 4 years in South Portland. And I would love to be able to utilize a more appropriate space for the school by adding, and also by adding a new and a more, a better living space for our family, and to also add a garage to our home, which will be beneficial to a neighborhood since all our bicycles and so forth can have a home, wheelbarrows and the rest of it.
Okay. How does the board want to approach this? You want to do it one item at a time?
I guess we've got a completeness issue first.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, and that's just for the wetland alteration permit, correct?
For both.
For both, all right. Don't we typically have a completeness challenge? We do, I'm sorry. It's on the last page this time.
You want me to go over it?
Well, I'm just checking to see if there's really any highlights, if you'd like to, please.
While you're reviewing it, under the site plan review checklist, there are no elevations that have been submitted, but the applicant has put them up on the board tonight, and most of the exterior structure is complete. Under item G, a waiver has been requested for providing setbacks from the property line. However, the front and side yard setbacks have been provided by the applicants. And under item H2, the applicants have not provided soils information. That is available under the previous subdivision approval, but what they've done instead is they've provided wetland plant information and used that to identify the soils boundary. They have also not shown the water line, which is item L3, but they have identified that the home is served by public water. Under the wetland alteration permit, there's a separate checklist on the following page, and they have requested a waiver for stormwater plan, and that is a waiver that the town engineer is concurring with. Are there any questions?
Mr. Chair, I have no questions. I think although the checklist is very thorough and there are certain items that are not entirely there, that we certainly have, in my judgment, sufficient information to go forward, and I would deem it complete.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I think I'll echo those comments. I'll also say that I think the board has somewhat, particularly with this type of application, been a little more informal in reviewing the checklist. I've seen in the packet that this particular, not this particular application, but this use is, has become somewhat of a concern at the council level with respect to the zoning ordinance. And at that point, I think it's appropriate to discuss issues of the type and level of detail that we'll be needing and looking for in the site plan review and any wetland applications. It occurred to me, I was thinking more in the neighborhood of a 6-student school. This is a 20-student school. This is essentially a small one-room schoolhouse. And I would just, I'd like to say for the record that I don't have any problems with the checklist, completeness checklist, but it would behoove the applicant to, I think, appreciate the fact that we can only review the application with respect to the information provided, and if there are any inaccuracies in the application, then that would affect the final approval of the site plan. And that's true of any application. That's not unique of this. I don't have any, I don't require any additional information to what I've seen. Thank you.
Any other comments regarding completeness from any of the board members? We should just go ahead and vote as to whether we do think it's complete or not. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. As to completeness, okay, it's unanimous.
Deemed motion.
Okay. I guess it's appropriate this time to open the public hearing. And okay, the public hearing is now open. If anyone from the audience would like to come up to the podium and comment or what have you, please do so. And please identify yourself and give your address.
Thank you. I'm Patty Wood-Bothell. I live at 9 Chevers Road in Cape Elizabeth. My daughter Amelia attends Pam's daycare, so I wanted to tell you a personal experience on what it's like to, as far as the site plan, as far as driving, how it's set up for them. This is her first year attending, so this is new to me, but I have had absolutely no problem. Pam is very easy on drop-off and pick-up time, so I think at the maximum I have seen maybe two other parents there at the same time I have been there. So that was a maximum of three cars. Since we have started school, there has always been construction going on, so there have actually been a couple of extra vehicles in the yard at most times, and there still has been no problem pulling in, turning around, and driving out. There is no backing up, backing out into the street. As you know, Two Lights Road is very flat, very, very good visibility. Their house sits a little bit down, so you can drive up. You can easily see if someone else is pulling out. My older daughter is also a friend of the Mullins' older daughter, so we have been invited to family functions where there have been many people parked. There has never been a problem there either that I have seen. And from living in Cape Elizabeth for quite a few years, I know there's strawberry picking going on across the street, and more than 20 cars are there at a time, and there doesn't seem to be any problem. So I think that they have definitely enough space in their site plan as far as people coming and going for the daycare.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak?
I just thought I could add a little bit to that. My name is Ted Reiner. I live at 119 Bowery Beach Road. My daughter Annie has gone to Pam's daycare for about 4 years, and well, I'm kind of a safety nut myself, and I've never seen anything that, as far as the coming and going and the traffic that looked hazardous to me. And in fact, I think it's unique, this location where you can actually look down the road 300 yards, maybe 400 yards in each direction, so there's a lot of anticipation time as far as pulling out onto the street, and I could concur that there's no backing out onto the road, and it's probably one of the safest locations as far as cars, so I just thought I'd add that.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Tricia Natif. I'm at 11 Fessenden Road, and my daughters have been going to Pam's for 4 years. I will echo the comments of my parent partners, but also want to say that at Fessenden Road, we're also a neighbor of the Mullins right off of Two Lights Road. So in addition to saying, yes, it's safe and the parking is very adequate, and I think will be for additional people, and I understand Mr. Emery's concern, but for the space, I think it's adequate for the children as well as for the traffic. I also want to comment, since you've not had a chance perhaps to see it from a neighborhood perspective, it's a beautiful building designed by a very talented person. And so just in terms of the neighborhood, the addition is a real asset, I think, to the design of the properties in the neighborhood. So would echo what everybody said, and also if you haven't seen it, you should go look.
Thank you.
My name is Warren Roos. I live at 578 Ocean House Road. I've watched the Mullins property go up almost like a slow time-lapse movie, and I'd just also like to say that it's well thought out, the parking is easy, and that it is really quite lovely. They even have a little board there so that it makes a sound as you come and go. Quite smart, and I wish I had that much parking myself.
Thank you. Anyone else? Seeing no one else, the public hearing is closed. Any discussion or questions from board members? Mr. Emery?
I just think so. The public appreciates that we're thorough in our review without being onerous. Would you just explain where it is that the students enter your house once they leave the parking spaces?
It would be, there's a breezeway here, and that's where there's a door.
In the, okay.
There's also a door here and a door back going out back, but this would be the door.
And presumably anything that you're doing with the house that requires, as we discussed in the workshop, that requires this type of occupation or use is meeting whatever the local building code enforcement officer has requested as part of the building permit. And again, for the public record, that's not the purview of the planning board. Certainly our packet indicates that there's absolutely no concern with the, at least the, what appears to be the immediate abutters, and indeed there is a lot of support for the project. I think that's a very helpful situation. In certain conditions, a smaller lot perhaps, or a lot in a more densely developed area, for instance, in the neighborhood I live in, I would think that 20 students showing up at a single family residence could create more of an impact in the neighborhood. That's not the case here. My only comment that I would offer under the site plan review issue is in the way in which the cars are parked, it's all logical and functional, but it would appear that there may be some danger in someone leaving a parking space with a child or a child escorted, and admittedly they usually are escorted, and having a car back out in the path of travel, that there's nothing indicated that there's a walkway in front of the cars that would take someone along the front of the cars, then back and behind. That would be an argument that an attorney would make after the accident had occurred. It would only appear obvious then, and that's the only reason I raise a comment now. I clearly understand that everybody who goes to a mall or whatever typically gets out of the car, walks behind the car, and goes down the maneuvering lane to get to the stores. They don't use the sidewalks in front of the cars, but you may want to indicate something on your plan or something, have an alternative means for people to either get from the door to the car so that particularly smaller children are not walking behind cars that may be backing out.
Any other questions or comments?
Most people, when they're backing out, I usually, if I'm in that area at all, I give them the flag down.
Yeah, I fully appreciate it. And
Mr. Parker, I'm Ms. Mullen, as I understand it, you run a daycare right now for 6 children, and we are considering an expansion to either 15 or 20, mm-hmm. so that's a significant mm-hmm. expansion. What are the hours that people drop off kids in the morning and pick them up in the afternoon right now?
8 to 5 are my hours right now, though.
But is
the bell doesn't ring at 8 and the bell doesn't ring at 5.
Is there a concentration between 8 and 9, or do people?
It's between 8 and 9, but between 8 a.m. and 9 a.m. But there's very seldom this, you know, large concentration mm-hmm. of people at that time or at pickup time, and I would never allow it to be any more than a few parents at one time, because I really feel strongly about meeting with each individual parent or guardian at pickup time.
So if you were to have 15 children, what would your plan be in terms of times to be dropped off in the morning and times to be picked up in the afternoon?
That's a good question. I'd probably continue the same, but maybe do more at 3:30 and 4, 4:30 and 5 to have a staggered pickup time.
I don't intend to have 20 children today or tomorrow. It's just something that I know the state will license me for, and I would like the town to acknowledge that as well, so that I don't have to go through this process again.
I can certainly appreciate that concern of yours. The town engineer had a problem with the 18-foot width of the driveway and was suggesting that it be made 20. Is that something that you have a position on, one way or the other?
I went out that following day with my measuring tape and measured the neck here, and it's actually 18 feet, 8 inches. And if I stretch the grass off that's grown in over the asphalt, it would be 19 feet. And I have no problem telling you that I will make sure that the gentleman who snowplows will snowplow 20 feet, and if it's a matter of cars driving on the grass, that's okay with me, either side for oncoming traffic.
What happens now when cars meet each other, or have you ever been aware of that?
There really has never been any parking problems, so I'm unaware of that. I was asking Peter. I said, you're out there more often than I am, and it must be that they actually drive a little bit on the grass. That's the only thing I can figure, but it's okay. And people occasionally park on the grass if we're having special functions.
And there's no, I mean, it's a flat
It's
area.
Fairly flat. There's a little bit of an incline going down, but it's fairly flat.
I have no further questions.
Any other questions or comments? Mr. Wilcox?
On the plan, parking space 2, 3, 4, and 5 indicate sort of a backing toward the garage and then driving forward. So far, everyone tonight has said that you wouldn't have to back out onto the street at all. Is there enough room for parking space number 1 to back in the direction of the porch or the main house and then pull forward? Parking space number 1 indicates only backing out, not driving out.
Parking space number 1. You would have to back into that space, which is what I do when I park there.
Oh,
because
okay.
I prefer
so
to pull out
forward.
In a parking spot than I do back out.
Okay.
So number 1, yes. The others, no problem with the other ones. And after I drew this up and submitted it, we had a party, and there were 9 cars comfortably parked. I made a point to look out to see, and there were actually 9 cars, and I believe there's 8 spaces I've allowed here that day. And there was sufficient space for doors to open and shut and people to back out.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? Could we hear a motion from someone? Okay.
If I can find it. Motion for the board to consider findings of fact. 1, Peter and Pamela Mullen are proposing to expand an existing daycare to 20 children and to build an addition which is partially located in an RP2 wetland, which requires site plan review and a wetland alteration permit. Number 2, the applicant has previously received approval from the zoning board to expand the daycare to 15 children, and subsurface sanitary disposal was demonstrated for a capacity of 15 children. 3, the applicant received a building permit and began construction of the addition prior to notification that a portion of the addition is located in an RP2 wetland. 4, the plan substantially complies with section 19-2-10 site plan review and section 19-3-9 wetland regulations. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Peter and Pamela Mullen for site plan review of a daycare for 20 children and a wetland alteration permit for construction of an addition partly in an RP2 wetland located at 44 Two Lights Road be approved with the following condition. 1, that the applicant demonstrate that a subsurface disposal system has adequate capacity to accommodate a daycare for 20 children prior to expanding the daycare beyond 15 children.
We have a second.
Second.
Any further discussion?
Mr. Chairman, we have a motion to approve a use for 20 students. I believe the permit from the zoning board is for 15 students.
Right.
Are we able to grant a motion for a use that's not permitted?
When the applicant went to the zoning board, she asked for 15. She explained to me that she's since considered moving up to 20, and I advised her that If she doesn't want to come back to the planning board again, she should get some kind of conditional approval for up to 20, so that she would still have to go back to the zoning board if she exceeds 15, but the planning board approval would already be in place.
And again, this is a state threshold that the 20 students. So a condition of approval should state up to 20 students.
I'll do that.
I would suggest that the motion be amended to state up to 20 students.
Accepted.
Any further discussion?
In order to accommodate Tom's concern, it seems to me that we ought to have a number two condition, which is that the applicant receive approval from the zoning board to expand the daycare center from 15 children to 20 children.
That's correct.
Agreed to on the second. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I must say again that it is nice to see an application so well supported in the community. Thank you.
Okay, the next item on our agenda is On Our Planet Day School site plan. Kate Williams Hewitt and Suzanne Martin Pillsbury are requesting site plan review to operate a day school for up to 20 children located at 250 Ocean House Road, property owned by John and Jerry Hewitt. The applicants received approval from the zoning board in September to operate a day school for up to 20 children. The application will be reviewed for compliance with Section 19-2-10 site plan review.
For the board's information, the first thing you would be considering would be completeness again, and there is a checklist in the last page in your package. The only item that I have identified is that there has been no stormwater plan submitted. However, there isn't any surface alteration proposed by the application, and I suspect the applicant was intending to request a waiver of this item. Are there any questions on that?
No.
Okay, would you like to give us a little bit of a brief summary of what you're proposing?
Hi, I'm Kate Williams Hewitt, and this is Suzanne Pillsbury, my partner. And we're located at 250 Ocean House, which is right across from the Hillway on Ocean House Road. You can tell our driveway from the black mailbox. This is our driveway coming in. There's an existing home, and Suzanne and I are attempting to put a school in the bottom half of the home. People enter through the driveway, and there's a turnaround. There's a circular driveway and the parking on the side. The front door is used for entrance. We meet the children. The school is located downstairs, and then there's another door that goes out to our fenced-in playground, and that's where we play.
We currently have 6 children enrolled, and we started We started in September with just 2 playmates and Kate's 2 children. And then when we got approval from the zoning board, we began with 6 additional children. So currently we're running with that.
If you have any questions, we'd be glad to answer them.
Okay, thank you. Okay. We need to vote on the completeness issue. Is there any issues that anyone wants to discuss or doesn't think is complete?
No, I would just reinforce the comments I made with the previous application. It'll be sorted out, I think, through the council review and probably planning board review of the 20 stu-, I'm thinking of the 20 student end of the spectrum, not the 6 student end. And again, the applicant is reviewed based on the information submitted, which is obviously part of the approval.
Okay. Any other questions before we... Okay. As to completeness, could you have a show of hands to see how we feel?
Would you like a motion?
Certainly.
Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the applicants Kate Williams Hewitt and Suzanne Martin Pillsbury for site plan review of On Our Planet, a day school for up to 20 children located on property owned by John and Jerry Hewitt at 250 Ocean House Road, be deemed complete.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor? It's unanimous? Okay. Time to open the public hearing. Is there anyone from the audience that would like to speak?
Instead of asking our parents tonight, we had them write letters to you, which you all received.
Okay. Well, seeing none, public hearing is closed. Great. Discussion. Mr. Emery.
Do you have some place to be at 8:50?
As a matter of fact.
At the workshop, there was a question from Mr. Fisher regarding the activities of the children and some concerns about noise level. And as anyone who's seen his house realizes he has a wonderful house in a nice, quiet setting, as quiet as Route 77 can be. But I live a little more asymmetrically on the other side of Route 77, and it is a quiet area. I saw in the packet some discussion about some fencing. Have you agreed to do something?
Yeah, we talked to Mr. Fisher privately, and he gave us his blessing. We asked him for his blessing, and he gave us his blessing. We agreed that we would put a stockade fence up where the original fence is.
In the back of it, this side, his property is here, the play yard fence is here. Currently, there's a fence there, and this would become a stockade.
To block the noise.
Just to block the noise.
Okay. Is the pool area separate from the fence play area?
Locked, off.
Stockade fence right here.
What is your response to the concerns about the width of the driveway? And I believe it says it's 100 feet long and there's only room for one car to get by.
Actually, like Pam had described, we've had two cars go by and there's grass on either side, so there is room and we have gotten a proposal. If the board deemed, we have looked at the front of the yard, which is 11 feet, 11 feet in the width, and understand that is a different scenario, and are willing to widen that so that two cars can get in without any hesitation or...
And we had someone look at it.
And given us a proposal to do the work, and it can be done within 30 days.
Cars about 6 to 7 feet wide, depend upon whether it's a car or suburban coming in. I think, depending upon the number of students you have, sooner or later, either you'll get tired of maintaining the grass, filling in the ruts in the springtime, and maybe widen it. I don't have any pressing concern about dealing with it at this point. I don't know if the board, I'm fairly familiar with this property. The only other concern I think for the public record is that this is a 35 mile an hour speed limit. It's an extreme down slope, and cars tend to go about 40 to 45 because a 45 mile an hour speed limit is just down the road and they see it and they're gone. And people pulling out of here are pulling this time of year. The sun is extremely low coming down that hill, and That's the only concern I have, but that's regardless of whether we approve this or not, that's an ongoing situation.
Okay. Carlson?
Yes, as far as plowing in the wintertime, do you stick to 11 feet, or is there room on each side of that road to push snow?
There's more than 20 feet on either side, and there's no trees. We went down and measured it, and my husband will be snow plowing, and there's room, and so the snow banks will be off beyond 20 feet.
Fine, thank you.
Any other questions, please?
Just one that's not entirely relevant, but I didn't understand something that you had said earlier. Are you two related?
No.
So it's your father that is the owner of, your father and mother are the owners of the house?
My father-in-law.
Father-in-law.
Yeah.
Fair enough. But just wanted to clarify that. Thank you.
Very nice man.
I'm glad you think so.
Yes.
I hope the school board's taking notice of all of these applications, by the way. Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Emery?
May I submit a motion?
Please do.
This is a motion for approval of findings of fact. Kate Williams Hewitt and Suzanne Martin Pillsbury are requesting site plan approval for On Our Planet School for up to 20 children, which is located at 250 Ocean House Road. 2, adequate circulation and parking must be provided on-site to assure safety for children, parents, and operators. The plan substantially complies with Site Plan Review Section 19-2-10. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Kate Williams Hewitt and Suzanne Martin Pillsbury for site plan review of On Our Planet, a day school for up to 20 children, located on property owned by John and Jerry Hewitt at 250 Ocean House Road, be approved with the following conditions. That no cars be parked in the cul-de-sac area in front of the garage so that they block vehicular circulation around the cul-de-sac.
Do we hear a second?
Second.
Any further discussion?
There is no second condition. It may have appeared that way, but there was none.
Any further discussion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good luck to you both. Maureen, I do have one comment on Vaughn Dyer's, the patrolman. I note that he was discussing the site distance for 250 Ocean House Road, and the last conclusion is that the distances measured well exceed the recommended site distance of 100 feet per mile per hour. I don't think it's 100 feet per mile per hour, because then you'd require 3,500 feet, so you might want to suggest that he correct that the next time.
Good luck.
The last item on the agenda under other business is proposed zoning ordinance request by the town council for review and comments on the proposed zoning ordinance section 19-4-9 amendments. In a conversation with the town planner, we decided it's awkward at best to try to do this at this type of meeting would be much more effectual to do it at a workshop. So I want to get the consensus of the board that how everyone feels.
Yes.
And out of consideration for the viewers at home.
Yeah. That was So I guess given that, if everyone feels that that's more appropriate, then we will push that off to the December, whatever the date is, workshop.
The second, is it?
Sounds right.
Something in there.
Third's a workshop.
And with that, I guess we'd ask for a motion for adjournment?
So moved.
Oh, wait. There's a motion we need to do here.
Motion to table?
By the way, excuse me.
Oh, I'm sorry. I missed that. We have a motion for that?
Before we do that, could we just discuss the fact that in the memorandum that we got handed out, there seemed to be photocopies of some interesting tabs? Was that done on purpose, or?
You mean?
What did you get?
As in, on page 2, it looks like a yellow tab questioning something. Page 3, another tab questioning something. Page 4, I mean, it's wonderful that somebody's so thorough, but.
Glad they hadn't showed them to me before they copied it.
This is from the Macintosh computer, which has the stickers right on both of the.
This is what it looks like in the original.
Yeah, well, it's usable, but it might help to have a more thorough document.
I'll get that cleaned up and back to you.
No, it's fine.
Among other things.
Good thing you were careful with your comments.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Emery?
Motion. And be it ordered that consideration of the draft zoning ordinance be tabled to the December 17th, 1996 Planning Board meeting, at which time a public hearing shall be held, and in the meantime, the December 3rd, 1996 Planning Board workshop will review the ordinance.
Second.
All those in favor? It's unanimous. One question I had, there was a bunch of things that had been parked in the
parking lot.
Is that going to be part of this discussion at the workshop?
That is the choice of the planning board.
How does everyone feel about that?
I guess my sense would be to go through this thing first, and if we have any extra time to talk about the parking lot, but.
Okay. Everyone feel comfortable with that?
Is this going to be the only thing on the workshop in December? I hope.
No, there has been one person so far that's asked to come to the planning board and has agreed that they could wait till the January workshop.
Mm-hmm. You mean other than?
Other than, yes, the zoning review.
I think most of us were there for a majority of the meeting, so it's not going to require that much detail going through this. So. Okay, with that, we have a motion for adjournment.
Can I make a suggestion on reviewing the zoning ordinance, that if you have any requests for cleaning up of language or spelling or punctuation or any administrative comments you'd like to make, that you make them in writing to the planner before the workshop, so our discussion can remain substantive and make best use of our time rather than just go through housekeeping issues? Just in the interest of time, because I can see ourselves spending 5 hours on this, and it's a very dry subject. I mean, if we could save an hour by doing some of the house cleaning before the meeting begins, it would be helpful.
Well, I've already had my shot at it.
Yeah. And you've done very well, thankfully.
And, Mark Ironman will be attending the workshop.
Oh, you will.
Good.
Good.
Is there some, this is maybe a silly question. Is there someone who is going to go through and do the cleanup on the wording, the typos, and the punctuation? Even after we go through, and hopefully we won't dwell on that part of it at all?
If you find something, you should pick it up, because we have been doing that all the way through, and you know, after the planning board's through with it, it'll go to the council, still has another layer of review, and Mark Ironman and I are supposed to be picking up all of those things as well, but if you find something, just mark.
But this is supposed to encompass everything that got picked up in the joint sessions, right?
This supersedes the purple book.
Right, because this is November the 12th. I mean, that's
right.
Fairly recent date.
This is the everything that was changed by the Joint Zoning Review Committee. This is now the most current copy, and the only ones that have a copy are you. So.
Great.
And Mark Arms.
Yes.
Good. All right. Motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Ooh, a second.
Second.
All those in favor? Great. Thank you. All of us? Okay.